Thank you very much for the invitation. Thank you for coming. So it's a joint work with colleagues from INS Lyon, Colin Genier, Stéphane Thomassé, Rémi Vatrigan, and Eunjung Kim from Paris Dauphine. And I want to talk about a new graph parameter that we introduced and that we call trinwidths. But before that, let me ask you a very vague question. So what is the most general tractable class? So it's too vague. I didn't tell you what tractable was. And also there is no reason why there should be a unique answer to that. There could be incomparable classes with favorable algorithmic properties. So let's put the parole and let's see what examples of this we had throughout the history. So in the 80s and 90s, there was truits introduced, and on graphs with bounded truits, some logic was decidable, so namely MSO logic. A quick disclaimer, there will be many things that would require a definition, like truits, rankwidths. If I don't do it, it means that it won't be really necessary for understanding the talk. It's just some context, and if you know it, it's great. If you don't, it should not really bother you too much. I will just give you some rough intuition. So bounded truits is a generalization of trees. Bounded rankwidths, you can think of it as generalizing both cographs and also bounded truits. So on those classes that are more general, we can still solve second order logic, but a fragment of it, a subfragment of it. And there was also a program on sparsity. Again, nowhere dense. We don't need a formal definition. Think of it as generalizing bounded degree graphs or planar graphs. And on those classes, first order logic was tractable. So you could bring a lot of answers to this vague question. If you were interested in approximation algorithm, maybe bounded VC dimension would be where to look. On perfect graphs, we know how to solve some problems efficiently. And I added some other things. And actually, the more or less everything that we'll cover in this talk appear on this slide, but in a different order. So we'll have a very transversal approach. So we'll indeed generalize things. So we'll generalize bounded rankwidths, meaning that for theory we'll generalize bounded truits, but also some of those sparse classes, some of those nowhere dense classes, H minor free classes. And we'll see what those are, posets with bounded width and permutations avoiding a fixed pattern. So for a generalization of all these classes, which seem quite different, we'll be able to solve first order model checking efficiently. So this is the rough summary of what will happen. So you see that we're trying to generalize bounded rankwidths. And bounded rankwidths is itself a generalization of cographs. So let's start from the start to generalize cographs, but in a different way than with rankwidths. So rankwidths, to give you a rough idea, you would split your graph recursively, and in between two parts, you would have, if you look at the bipartite graph between them, the matrix would have small rank. So what is a cograph first? A single vertex is a cograph, and you can build further cographs by taking disjoint union of two cographs, or by taking the complement of this, by taking so-called complete sum. So you take two cographs and you link them by all the edges in between. A characterization which is useful for us here of cographs is that you can iteratively find twins. You can find two twins, two vertices with the same neighborhood, identify them, and you can iterate this process until you reach a single vertex. So a natural way to generalize those co-graphs would be to say we'll allow to identify things that are not twins but close to being twins that have almost the same neighborhood. So let's try to see why this definition would fail. This would not lead to a class with good algorithmic properties. And the reason for that, it's too general. So for instance, this graph, it's a universal graph for bipartite graphs. So on one side, I have the integers from 1 to n, here 4. On the other side, I would have all the sets. So all the bipartite graphs are induced subgraphs of this if I would prolong it sufficiently high. And there will be a sequence of identification of things that are as close as possible as being twins. They will differ just on one neighbor, on one neighbor. So why this complicated graph passes the test? I can find pairs of vertices that differ only on one, so the empty set and one. So I could identify them, and I could take 1, 2, and 2, identify them, and so on and so forth. So if I do this, I will reach this point where now one is linked to everything on the right, and 2, 3, 4. Now they define with the rest of the graph the same thing, but at height -1. So I could continue this scheme and contract the whole graph into a single vertex. Yet I don't want this graph to be treated as simple. So we need just one more ingredient to actually come up with the definition of twin widths. And this ingredient is to keep track of the errors. So you see, I've made many errors linked to one. If I would keep the errors on the edges by drawing them in a different color, and I would impose that the red degree remains bounded, then I have exactly the definition of twins. So we'll still precise things. So I will still take two more slides to define twin widths, but that's really the idea. So we'll now work with three graphs. So graphs with some edges colored in a different way. Think of them as error edges. And we have this operation of identification or contraction. So it's not an edge contraction. You don't need necessarily an edge in between U and V to contract them. They could be here, anything. So a non-edge, a black edge, or a red edge. So if you decide to contract U and V, what happens is that all the edges towards the symmetric difference of their neighborhood will be colored red. So here that would be towards U1, U2, U3, that were private neighbors of U, and also V1, V2, V3, that were private neighbors of V. And for what happens in the intersection of the neighborhood, red is absorbent in the sense that if you had one red edge and one black edge, it's red. Two red edges, it's red. Only two black edges will give a black edge. So this is tree graphs and contractions. Now, what's a contraction sequence? And what is twin widths? So we want to go all the way to a single vertex, starting for our graph. And what will be important is the overall maximum degree of the red graph, of the graph induced only by the red edges. So let's see what happens on this graph. So I can try to contract E and F. So if I do this, I would reach this graph, where you see that before E and F, they were differing on A and D. So I will have two red edges forming. And now the maximum red degree of this graph is 2. So the overall maximum red degree of the whole sequence is 2. So now I can contract A and D. So if I do this, my two red edges from A to EF and D to EF will collapse into 1. But at the same time, I will create a new red edge to G. and so on and so forth. So here that would be a sequence where you see that the overall maximum red degree will never exceed 2. So if something like this happens, then I call this a 2 sequence or sequence of 2 contractions. In general, if I would never exceed degree D, that would be a D sequence. And that D sequence witnesses the fact that the twin width is at most D. Is there any question about the definition of twin width? I guess not. So I'm keeping an eye on the chat. So if you have a question, you can just write it. So sorry,
just a question. So you say it's at most 2. Is it exactly the maximum, or it can be less than the maximum?
Like, so here so for this particular graph, it would be exactly 2.
I mean, is it a definition of the twin width, or
the definition would be to the sequence minimizing this overall maximum red degree. Yeah, sorry, okay. That's a good question.
Okay, it's the best sequence. Okay, yeah. Thanks.
So let's see twin widths in action on some easy examples. So we'll see that classes with bounded twin widths are very general. There will be many classes that we know that have bounded twin widths. Let's start with a gentle example, trees. So in trees, you can find a 2 sequence. So the twin widths of trees is 2. So how do you do this? You observe 2 rules. Either you contract 2 twin leaves, so 2 leaves with the same parents. So here we can do it on the right. So we do this contraction, nothing red happens. And you see that now I don't have 2 leaves that have the same parent. So I have to do something different. I will just take a deepest leaf, so to my extreme left, and I will contract it with its parent. So if I do this, I reach this tree graph. Now I created just this one red edge. Here I still don't have twins. So I observe the second rule. And now I have 2 leaves that are twins, so I can contract them. So it doesn't matter that there is a red edge, I will contract them and reduce the degree to 1. And so on and so forth. So this cannot create a vertex with red degree 3, because it would mean that you would have forgotten to contract 2 twin leaves before you contracted, following the second rule of contracting a leaf with its parent. So that would finish like this for this tree. So actually this, I mean, you need a bit more ideas, but you can generalize the fact that trees have bounded twin widths to bounded true widths and even to bounded rank widths. So we have direct arguments to bound the twin widths of those graphs. Let's take another example now with unbounded rank widths, grids, so those graphs. So we'll see that not only this graph has bounded twin widths, but I can even show it with this graph where I complicate my life. I colored red some of the edges. So the way to do that is to contract the top left vertex with its neighbor just to its right here. So I do this, I end up with this graph. And then I do the same with those 2 vertices. I hope you can see the pointer. And I continue like this until I reach this, which is the same grid with 1 less column. So I can continue this scheme until I reach just a path with red edges, and then contract the path from one endpoint to the other. So that would be, you see that the red degree never exceeded 4. So that would be a 4 sequence. So showing that planar grids, they have twin widths 4, at most 4. And we can generalize this to grids in higher dimensions. So we would, the twin roots would depend on D, so it's just a linear bond. So the twin roots of D-dimensional grids is bounded by 3D. Okay, so we saw grids. What about planar graphs? And here we will hit a difficulty. And the difficulty is the following. So we could hope to show that planar graphs have bounded twin roots by showing that for a sufficiently large integer D, when you have a planar tree graph with red degree at most D, you can always find a good contraction, a contraction that would preserve both the planarity to stay in your class, and also that the degree, the red degree, remains below D. Unfortunately, that's not possible, and that's a counterexample of that statement, where the contraction would be cylindrical. So here there would be an edge between y1 and y3, same with x1, x3, and this vertex would be identified to this vertex. So here you can check, but all the contractions, they will jump the degree to 5 somewhere, or they will create the K5 minor, so they will make this graph non-planar. So it seems that we need more powerful tools. We don't have direct arguments for planar graphs. But maybe it's time also to precise what we want to do with graphs of bounded twin roots. And the algorithmic application that we hinted at the first slide is that we can solve first-order model checking faster than usual. So maybe let's define a bit what is first-order model checking. So I won't give a formal definition, but hopefully just examples would be enough. So when you want to solve graph FO model checking, so you're given a graph and a first order formula. So the variables of the formula, they range over the vertices of the graph. You have existential and universal quantifiers. You can quantify over those variables, but you cannot quantify over sets. And in addition, you have the edge predicates and equality. So you're asking, does my graph, does my structure satisfy a given formula phi? So let's see on an example. So if phi would be this formula, so this problem of model checking phi has a name. Is it a general problem? So Nicolas cannot see the slides anymore.
Pour moi, ça marche. It's working for me.
Okay. Okay, so I will continue. So you had time now to think about this. So we want to find k vertices such that for every vertex, either it's the vertex that we already chosen, or it's adjacent to something that we chose. So this is k dominating sets. This is looking for k vertices dominating the rest of the graph. See another example. So now there is no universal quantification. We just want to find k vertices that would be all different and also pairwise non-linked. So this is k independent set. So you can express quite general things, but you remain local. So it's always finding k vertices with such or such property. And an example of something that you cannot solve is three coloring. And you cannot express, with first order logic is three coloring, for instance. You would need to quantify over sets. So you need second order logic. Okay, so that's first order model checking. And now we know what more or less what's first order formula, we can define on top of that FO interpretations and transductions. So interpretations, it's quite simple. It's just a new rule to define the edges of your graph. So you're saying it's not E of x comma y images, it's something that I will tell you by means of an FO formula, phi of xy. So if you negate E of xy, you're just defining the complementation of your graph. If you look at the second line, if we're taking all the previous edges, but also we'll add an edge if between x and y, if there is a common neighbor to x and y, so that would be a pass with two edges. So here we're defining the square of the graph. So we can define more general things, but they somehow sort of boil down to squaring or taking powers and complementing. One thing that I cannot do, for instance, with FO interpretation from one graph, is to build a graph with not the same number of vertices. So FO transduction would allow to do this and would allow more general things. So it allows two additional operations. So you can first color by a constant number of unary relations. And you can also delete some vertices if you want. And in between, you will have your FO interpretation. So let's start with this example here. So I color here, my constant number of unary relations would be 3. Now I interpret. So let's say this is the new rule for the edges. So you see that it starts with E of x comma y, or so I will keep all the edges that I see here. And then I will add some extra edges. So G, B, and R would be for the unary green, blue, and red. So here I would add an edge between a green vertex and a blue vertex if the blue vertex doesn't have a red neighbor. So you see that I have one green vertex. I will link it to those three blue vertices, but I won't link it to the other blue vertices because they have each a red neighbor. And if I did it correctly with the rest of the formula, I would add actually all those edges. And now I can delete and remove the colors, and I get a new graph, which is a transduction of my initial graph. So the coloring, you can see it as a non-deterministic step. So your FO transduction, fixing just one interpretation, one formula phi, will create actually many graphs. And similarly, you can define the FO transduction of a class. You would take every graph of your class, run it for each this FO transduction, producing many graphs for each, and you would end up with a class. Because we can delete things, it's trivially closed by inducer graph. So it's something that I want to call a class. So what we showed for that TwinWidth behaves very well with respect to transductions, it's preserved by transductions. So if you take any classes, any class with bounded TwinWidths, and any formula phi, you look at the class that you obtain with the transduction using the phi interpretation, it still has bounded TwinWidths. So we won't see a proof of this, but we will see a bit of the intuition behind the FO model checking, which is sort of the first step to this.
Edouard, you have a question in the chat.
Sorry. No, the deletion. Yeah, so normally you would define it through an FO formula. That's true. Here, I want to allow you to do whatever you want because I want your class to be closed by inducer graphs. But yeah, it's a good question. Yeah, let me just do a small incursion in model theory. This is really not needed. So if you don't understand what I'm saying here, it's really not a problem. But now we know what a transduction is, it's not too painful to define what a stable class is and what a nip class is. So a stable class means that you cannot find a transduction where you obtain all the half graphs or all the ladders. So those are the graphs that you see below here, where I wouldn't care if there are edges in between those vertices or in between those vertices. What I want to see induced in the graph is what happens between the two parts, this ladder thing here. And the class would be nip if you cannot obtain all the graphs by means of a transduction. So to give you some examples, so bounded degree graphs, they are stable. You cannot get this ladder structure of arbitrary heights. Unit interval graphs, they are nip. You cannot get all the graphs by transduction, but they are stable. Actually, you can get this graph. It is a unit interval graph if you add all the edges between those vertices and all the edges between those vertices. This is already a unit interval graph. You don't need to do any transduction. And finally, interval graphs, they are not nip. So from interval graphs, you can FO transduce to get all the graphs. So twin widths really follows the regime of unit interval graphs. It's nip, but in general not stable. So now we can see what is known about efficient algorithm to solve first order model checking. So this is a vast program that started with sparse classes. So there was a result in 96 by Cs that you can solve FO model checking when your graphs, your input graphs, have bounded degree in linear time with a function of the formula, which is quite horrible. And then for the next almost 20 years, they try to climb this ladder that you see here that is generalizing more and more generalizing planar graphs with more and more general classes, but they all are sparse. So those graphs, they have few edges. And to continue the parallel with model theory, those classes are stable. You cannot FO transduce to those ladders. So it ended up in 2014 with an almost linear algorithm for FO model checking on lower dense classes. And it was pretty much the end of the story because for classes that are closed by taking subgraphs, not by taking a new subgraph. So if you restrict yourself to those classes, it's the end of the story. FO model checking is easy to solve exactly on those nowhere dense. So if you go to the classes that are not nowhere dense, that are called somewhere dense, we have complexity theoretic reasons to believe that there is no such fixed parameter algorithm. And also, still within the realm of graphs that are closed by taking subgraphs, nowhere dense is equivalent to stable. So we have a full picture of what's happening here. It's almost the end of the story because now people in this community, they try to lift those results to transductions of those classes. So if you take a transduction from a nowhere dense class, you exit the sparse classes from a star. If you look at the square of a star, star is sparse, but the square of it is a clique. So you leave really this realm of sparse classes, but still you can hope to solve FO model checking. So it's basically what they want to achieve now, it's to show this result for transduction of nowhere dense classes. You might say, okay, but I could just go one step back, take the structure or the graph, which is sparse, and then when I want to solve this FO model checking, I would just plug everywhere I have this occurrence of the edge relation, the formula of the interpretation. But precisely what is difficult here is to go one step back. So you're just given the transduction of a nowhere dense graph, and it's difficult to retrieve from where you transduce it. So for instance, to give maybe a better example, deciding if a graph is the square of a planar graph is NP-hound. And on dense classes, so from 2000, we knew that on graphs of bounded rank widths, we can solve actually something more general than FO, so monadic second order logic one in linear time. There is this result which seems here like an outlier because it's not about model checking, but we'll see that it's very relevant later. So there was a wonderful algorithm by Sylvain Guillemot and Daniel Marx to solve permutation pattern in linear time in the size of the host permutation. In 2015, FO model checking solved in polynomial time on posets with bounded width. So posets with bounded width, there are posets with anti-chain of bounded size and map graphs. So what we showed is that actually you can do it on graphs with bounded twin widths, and that twin widths, bounded twin widths, sort of explains everything in this dense world. So bounded twin widths generalizes map graph, bounded rank widths, and so on. It also generalizes a part of what is going on in the sparse world. So it's a generalization of proper minor closed graphs, so KT minor free graphs, and maybe of polynomial expansion. So we don't know. This dash dotted here is that this could polynomial expansion could be included in bounded twin widths. Yeah, if it was not clear, so it's a Haas diagram. So everything going up is included in what is up. And the rest, when you don't have an edge, it means that we know that the classes are incomparable. So bounded twin widths is incomparable with bounded degree. So the caveat here is that we cannot do this without the sequence. So we need to be able to compute the sequence in order to solve the FO model checking algorithm. So this is our workflow to find the sequence and then run our FO model checking algorithm. So we start with this graph. We saw some examples already of this arrow. So in polynomial time, to find directly the d-contraction sequence. So we saw it with trees and grids. And I claim that it was generalizable to bounded rank widths, d-dimensional grids, and so on. So, but we also saw an example where it was not obvious. So for planar graphs, we didn't know what to do. So for those classes where we are stuck, we'll have to go through a detour, which is here going through this T mixed free order that we will see what that is. So it's an ordering of the vertex sets that will be useful to actually build later the contraction sequence. So this will actually take the rest of the talk. So we'll explore this just briefly. I should probably mention how the FO model checking works. So when you have the graph and the contraction sequence. So what we do is that we compute a tree of size L, where L is a parameter. And then we can, in constant time, so the constant would just depend on L, answer queries of the form, does G satisfy phi, when phi is a prenex formula of depth of quantifier depth L with L values. So the last arrow here is just a simple observation. So the hard is to build this tree. You see also this tree, the size of the tree does not even depend on the twin widths. Only the time needed to compute it is very much depends on the twin widths and on this parameter L. But then it's linear in the size of the graph N. So let's see in just one slide, one picture, how this this works really roughly and where twinwidth intervenes. So this is the slide. So it's a dynamic programming algorithm where it's maybe easier or better to think of the sequence not as a contraction sequence but as a partition partitioning sequence. So you start from your graph, and instead of actually performing the contractions, you put your vertices into bigger and bigger blobs until you reach the point where all the vertices are in the same blob. So here, if you look at the interaction between two blobs, there is no edge. It would mean that there is no edge at all between the vertices of x9 and x14. There is an edge would mean that there are all the edges between x13 and x14. And the red edge would be that there is at least one edge and at least one non-edge. And that's why you created this error edge here. So, okay, we'll start from the most refined partition and we'll compute trees that depends on the initial graph, on where we are in the partitioning scheme. And we will compute one for each blob. So the tree will have size function of L and height L. So let's say the next contraction is to contract X12 and X8 to obtain this graph. So you see, I did some one red edge here. Now I will have to update those trees that I computed. So I don't need to update all the trees. I only need to update those close enough to the action. So close enough to X16 and close it in the red graph. So I ignore the black edges. And close depends on this parameter L. So here I would have only to update the red and the blue blobs. I mean, their trees. And for that, I would only need to consider the blue and the green blobs. The gray blobs, they are too far. So you see that X5 is not even in the same red connected component. And X14 is in the same red connected component, but it's simply too far. So I don't need it to update. So now, without giving a proof why it works and where twinwidth intervenes, is that you see that my red graph, by definition, it has degree at most d, because I have a d sequence. And I need to look at a distance, I mean, to define the blue and the green blobs, I will need to look at a distance which is function of L. So I'm actually just touching here a constant number of blobs. It doesn't depend on n, it just depends on d and L. So, that's a bit of the intuition without giving too much. And now we can move to the last part where I should probably have started with this slide, which is the real reason we came up with the definition of twinwidth, which is the result that Rolly mentioned from Guillemot and Marx about permutation pattern. So permutation pattern, maybe we'll be clear on this example. You have a small permutation sigma, and you want to find it in a host permutation tau. And you're asking, can I have an algorithm which exponential part will be just limited to the size of sigma, not of tau? So it was believed that there is probably not such an algorithm. Let's see if it's clear. So here, that would be your pattern sigma. So you remove those gray things, you keep the black here, and they have exactly the same pattern. It was believed that there is no fixed parameter algorithm, and sigma is the parameter. And Guillemot and Marx proved this intuition wrong, and they showed even a linear algorithm in tau and exponential in sigma to solve this. And the proof went like this. So they used a breakthrough result by Marcus and Tardosh about permutations, which is not really a phrase for permutation. So let's try to parse this here. So if we have a zero matrix with a lot of ones, a lot is not so much, so more than a constant time n, where this constant depends on t, then it will be enough to find a t by t division, which is called a t grid minor, with one, at least one one in each cell, in each of the t squares cells. So here, this example would be a four grid minor. You see that in each cell, I have at least one one. So how do you use such a thing for permutations? Because if you start from a permutation, you have, I mean, the normal way of encoding the permutation, you would have n entries one. So you don't really learn anything from this theorem. So what's the idea of Guillemot and Marx is to do some operations to your initial permutation matrix. So I'm cheating a bit. It's not exactly how it works. But you might imagine like this, to contract rows and columns, or to delete rows and columns, and to keep some ones, so that comparatively the density of one increases. So at some point, this property will become relevant. So when it becomes relevant, when you have at some point with the current size n of your matrix more than this many entries one, then you can answer directly yes, because the sigma grid minor gives you actually all the possible permutation pattern. You just pick the one where you want it to build your permutation pattern. Now, what happens if the number of ones is always limited? Then you would find two rows or two columns which are very close together, which differ only on few entries. So again, it's not exactly how it works. They do contractions not on rows and columns, but on other objects. But they find two similar objects that they can contract. And if B happens all the time, it really resembles our contraction sequence. And actually, if you try to generalize this notion to graphs, you also end up with twinoids. So in that case, if B happens all the time, then you would conclude that your permutation 2, the host permutation, was simple enough. It has this decomposability that you can use algorithmically to by dynamic programming to find sigma or not as a pattern. So this is very interesting. So for us, it would be even better if we could make sense of it also in the dense setting, also starting from dense graphs or dense matrices. And for instance, cliques are simple, but they are not simple with respect to this definition. So with cliques, I would find very large grid minors. So I want a different definition. So I would say that the zone is simple, the cell is simple. It's complicated if it's mixed. So mixed means that it's not horizontal nor vertical. So it's not the copy of the same column vector and not the copy of the same row vector. And if I have a T by T division such that each of the T square cells is mixed, then I call this a T mixed minor. And my matrix is simple. My matrix is set T mixed free if it doesn't admit such a T by T division. So now we can have a parallel with how Guillemot and Marx used the result by Marcus and Tardosh. And we showed this statement. So if you can find a way to order the vertex set of your graph such that when you write down the adjacency matrix, it is T mix free, it doesn't have doesn't have a T mix minor, then the twin root is bounded by a large function of T, but it's bounded, it's double exponential in T in our proof. So there is a converse to that statement. Actually, the converse is simpler to show, but we will use this direction. But the converse tells you, with this result, tells you that you can think of twin roots of a matrix equivalently with notion of T mix readiness. So the way you use this to bound the twin roots of a class, you find a good way to order the vertex sets. And then you can reason by contradiction. So you say that, okay, now if I write the adjacency matrix with my good order, and I would find a T mix minor here, I cannot be, and the graph in the first place does not belong to my class. There is a contradiction somewhere. So we'll see examples of this now. A useful trick that we use is that the set of vertices that you take in rows, you can assume it to be different, to be disjoint from the set, in columns, disjoint from the set that you take in rows. So imagine you have a T grid minor. You can find a T over 2 grid minor with that property. So you just cut after the T over 2 division of your T grid minor, and then one of those two gray areas, they will necessarily contain T over 2 by T over 2 grid minors and are on disjoint sets of vertices. So let's try this on posets of bounded antichain size of bounded width. So maybe a warm up for this is the case of unit interval graphs, because you can interpret those graphs with posets of bounded width. So with my previous trick, I can be off the diagonal, and off the diagonal, if I order the vertex set by left-hand point in the representation with unit interval, the adjacency matrix would look like this. So the ones would be trapped in between two non-decreasing curves. And now just a geometric proof. If you try to fit here a 3x3 division, there will be necessarily one zone which is mixed. So here, in that case, that would be the central one here. There are only ones. It's constant, so it's not a mixed zone. So we'll give a more convincing proof for the more general case of posets of bounded widths now. So by Dilworth's theorem, if you have small anti-chain, then you can be partitioned into the same number of chains. So this is not, there is no polynomial algorithm for this, but there are good approximations. So if you have width k, if your maximum anti-chain is k, then in polynomial time, we can partition this into k to the log log k, which is good enough for us, chains. Then you take your chains and you just put them after the other. And this is your ordering. So why does it work? If you had a 3k mix minor, then it would imply a 3 mix minor between two chains. So here, tj and ti. Now, if I look at what happens between c2 and r2, there should be an arc somewhere. Otherwise, this cell c2 intersected with r2 would be only zeros, and this would not be mixed. So there has to be an arc. So let's say the arc is in that direction, and that I would encode with a minus one, because I'm encoding digraphs now. Now, by transitivity, I would have all the arcs going from C1 to R3, because C1 here is smaller than everything in C2, in particular this vertex, which is smaller than this, and smaller than R3. So I have all those arcs, meaning that in this zone, I have only minus one entries. So this zone cannot be mixed. Symmetrically, if I would have the arc in the opposite direction, so now it's a one in my matrix, I would have all ones in this square. So again, it's not I cannot fit a 3 mix minor here. So it means that the matrix was 3k mix 3, and by the previous theorem, it has bounded to immense. Okay, maybe I will skip this. So it also works with KT minor free graphs. You would, if you have a Hamiltonian path, you would use it in order to be able to contract those tracks here and reach a contradiction. So let me mention something about small classes. So it has nothing to do with what we saw so far. So a small class. So first, a class, I impose it to be closed by taking in new subgraphs. So it's small if, when I look at label graphs on the vertex set 1 to n, then I have less than n factorial times cn such graphs. So n factorial is already needed just to put the labels. And then from there, you only have something negligible. The multiplicative factor is negligible compared to n factorial, single exponential in n. So the result that we saw from Marcus and Tardosh actually implies that permutations avoiding a pattern sigma, fixed pattern sigma, is a small class. And by a result of Norin et al., also KT minor free graphs, so proper minor closed classes, are small. So we showed that bounded twin widths is small, which generalizes and extends those two results, because as we saw, bounded twin widths is a generalization of those classes. So this tells us that some classes have unbounded twin widths just because they are too large. So subcubic graphs, it's not a small class, so it has unbounded twin widths. Same for interval graphs, trigonal free unit segment graphs, they all have unbounded twin widths. So it's a bit particular because for subcubic graphs, we know by discounting argument that some of those graphs have unbounded twin widths, but we cannot really pinpoint here is a cubic graph or subcubic graph with large twin widths. So this is quite surprising. And then it would seem crazy to conjecture the converse, to conjecture that each bounded twin widths are classes are exactly the small classes. Why would the fact that you have only few graphs in your class mean that the twin width is bounded? But we have some reasons to believe that the converse might be true. I will mention some obvious open questions. So the most pressing question is to be able to compute, or at least to approximate, because computing is likely to be hard, twin widths in general, so in general graphs. We saw it only on some particular classes. There is this ongoing program of fully classifying classes where you can solve FO model checking efficiently, which now the next step is maybe to unify nowhere dense classes and bounded twin widths classes, because those two classes together, they more or less subsume what is known about tractable FO model checking. But yeah, unifying them is very non-trivial. Maybe it's not even the right approach. Regarding this conjecture that we saw on the previous slide, the small conjecture, the first step would be to show that polynomial expansion has bounded twin widths. So polynomial expansion is also a small class. So if you believe in the conjecture, you should be able to show it with polynomial expansion. And while we are exploring many different things, so getting better approximation algorithms on classes with bounded twin widths, whenever you have something working on matrices that are structured, trying to see if you can extend it to the maybe more general bounded twin widths. and seeing connections with twin widths and groups, where you would look at the twin widths of finite induced subgraphs of K graphs. So yeah, the many things here. So if you were interested, the first paper is already on archive. So the one about this talk, more or less, the tractable F-formula checking. And soon we'll put the second paper about small classes in maybe a matter of days. And then something, so the F-formula checking is quite, the complexity is quite horrible. So something more reasonable for maximum independent sets. The fact that bounded twin widths classes are archive-bounded and link with approximation for those problems. So, right, that's it. I thank you a lot for your attention, and I will be happy to take questions.
Thank you, Edouard. It was a great talk.
Thank you. So what is the dependency on the length of the formula in O of N? Usually exponential or super exponential. If it's the dependency of the algorithm, so it's a tor of the tor of function. This O of N here, the dependency on L and D is a tor function, so it's a expansion, and the height depends on linearly on L and D. Was this your question? Okay. Yeah, and yeah, it's indeed necessary. So for unit interval graphs, for instance, there is the matching lower bound, I mean, almost matching lower bound, that you need actually a tower, even on trees, actually. So what is known about FO transduction of bounded twin widths classes? So transduction, they preserve bounded twin widths. The way to, just to sketch it, so the way to do this, you take the sequence and you further refine your sequence by using the formula that you use for the interpretation.
Okay, let's see if we have one more question from Sylvain, and then yep. I can stop the recording, maybe.
New classes are characterized by forbidding FO transduction of some graphs. Same with stable classes. Anything similar here? So No. And yeah, the fact that twin width is preserved by FO transduction might be an obstruction to have some nice answer to a nice characterization to this.